there, YouTubers, and welcome to this Look Inside. Now, this Look Inside is going to be a little bit different because what we want to do is sort out the issue with the Isotek IPS3202 power supply. This is the giveaway in the Isotek competition that Paolo is involved in. He obviously sent this to me and I did a quick kind of review of it on one of my T4Ds. There was an issue with the overcurrent protection. It's got dual outputs, and when you had a single output, the overcurrent protection would switch off the output if you reached a threshold in the current level. However, when you set it to its parallel mode and you have both outputs slaved together so you could use them through one output, when you set the overcurrent protection, it would cut in prematurely, it would go in too early. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna demonstrate that error again quickly. And then what we're gonna do, we're gonna open it up, we can have a quick look inside just to see what it looks like. But the main goal of this exercise is, Paolo has sent me two EEPROMs with updated firmware. So the factory has had to go and redo their firmware and update their IC packages to update this power supply. The one package is kind of a standard dual inline package, that's an EEPROM, and the other small package, which is a 32 PLCC package, and I'll give you a closer look once we're on the bench. This is a 512K, what they call super flash EEPROM. So that's what we need to insert. I have just gone and purchased off Amazon a set of IC pullers. So we're gonna jump in, pull out the other ICs, put these in and see if they resolve the problem. So let's get down to the bench. Right, so here we go. What I'm gonna do, I'm gonna demonstrate the issue first. I've got my electronic DC load powered on and I'm gonna slowly crank up the current. Now, as you can see, I've got a current limit set on this of 1.5 amp. At the moment, we're only drawing half an amp, and as you can see, it's in its CV state, or its kind of control voltage state. And what we're gonna see here is when I don't have the overcurrent protection switched on, it'll just go up and then hold the current at the 1.5 amp limit, but the output will still be on. The idea of the overcurrent protection is that you can obviously set this, and if something hits a certain point, it'll switch off the output. But that's where the issue is. It switches off prematurely when it's in the parallel mode. So I'll crank things up now. Just keep an eye on the display. So here we go. We're going up. I'll take it up fairly quickly. You can see I've hit 1.5 amp, and it's just gone into the CC mode where it's kind of controlling the current. So no issue. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to roll it all the way back to something low because it seems to kind of almost be at a halfway point. I'll take it down to just below half an amp. I'm going to switch on the overcurrent protection. You can see the on notation has come on at the bottom here. And now I'm going to start cranking up. And there we go. When it hits like 750, so it looks like almost like it almost divides by two. And that's where the overcurrent protection is jumping in prematurely and dropping off the output. So that's the bug we hope to fix. So I've demonstrated it now. We're gonna switch it off, open it up, replace the chips, and see if it fixes it. Right, so I've got the two IC packages out of the little paper bag that it came in. I have ensured that I've catered for static. I do have a static strap, although I don't have it around my wrist. I've used that, and this is an anti-static mat, so I'm fairly happy in terms of that's been taken care of. Just as an aside issue, the one handy tool I find, because I end up opening up so many boxes and packages, it's always handy to have a nice, relatively sharp knife to either open up packages or boxes. So literally, this little Gerber, or should I say Gerber, knife, I must say, very handy. I went and purchased off Amazon. And then for if I've got slightly bigger work, I've got this Spyderco. So it seems like an odd thing to bring up, but it's kind of one of those tools in the workplace which can be really handy. Of course, with these, you need to be really careful because they can be sharp, but hopefully you realize that. Right, so I'm gonna bring you in for a closer look at these packages. The actual details certainly of this flash ROM IC I'll put below the video. Right, so these are the IC packages with the updated firmware. As I said, this is a 32 PLCC, so it's a plastic package with 32 pins around the side. This is a dual inline package, EEPROM. It does have this little cover over the window, which is obviously used for erasing it. The details, as I said, I'll place underneath the video on this package. This is 512, I believe this is 64K. I could be wrong, but I'll bring you in a little closer and you can try and pick up the numbers on it and look it up if you like. Right, so there we go. You can see the numbers on the bottom of the dual inline package chip. I'm just gonna tilt this because the light is a little bit challenging on this other IC.
But there you can read it says 29EE512. So that is the identifier on the chip, if you'd like to go and look it up yourself. Surely not. Okay, so I've got all these screws out of the sides and the top is still being held down, so I'm assuming the screws in the actual handles are playing a part in this as well. Can't see anything at the back that would be holding it, so take those off. Actually, yeah, I suppose it does make sense because there's a lot of weight in this, so you'd almost want the handle, if possible, going through to something solid inside the actual power supply itself. Yeah, and that is the case. So the top will come off. Okay, heavens. Heavens above. There's a rather big transformer in there. I'll just tilt it over. So there you go. What I'll do is I'll bring the camera in for a top view so we can have a closer look at the internals.
Right, so I'm going freehand with this because I kind of looked and I think, where on earth do I start? There's kind of a fair bit going on inside. So I'll just quickly pan around with the camera so that you can get a look inside. Ultimately, what I'm trying to hunt out is to see where those EEPROMs are located. On the side here, interesting, there's those fuses which are soldered onto the board. It looks like it's noting that they are half amp fuses. I'll see if we can get you a bit closer. Looks like half amp fuses, and then those must be the relays as you're clicking through the different voltage ranges, which you hear clacking away as you change your levels on the dials. So there is a package over there. I'm not sure whether that might be the flash EEPROM. I'll just take you to over the top. What I'll do, I'll see if I can take this metal bracing off so we get a better view inside, but there's the great lumping transformer. This beast really is heavy to actually pick up. I'll swing it around so we can have a look on the other side. Right, so here's the other side of it. We've got the obviously the main power input coming on this side over here, and then the main power switch on the front is located here and has got its wiring coming back through to the back here, which obviously then goes and controls what you're going to get out on your transformer to actually power it. And there are loads of tappings coming off this transformer. I'll just bring you in a little closer, but you can read some of the voltages presumably on the primary and the secondary side are noted on the transformer. So there's tappings that side, and there's quite a few on the other side as well. There's a heat sink located in the back there where the fan is, and I would be taking a stab at the dark to know what that component is on the top over there. I wonder if it's some kind of thermal switch. Initially, I think it was an actual IC of sorts, but perhaps maybe it's looking at the connectors on it, that must be a thermal switch, I'm guessing. We've then got that aluminium piece coming off the heatsink. Right, and attached to that heatsink, I'm assuming what looks like are bridge rectifiers. So there's 1, 2, 3, what I assume to be bridge rectifiers. And then another 2, no 3, tucked away there, what I assume to be transistors of some sort. Could be wrong. Let's just see if I can get in to see any information on there so someone can go and look it up. So that's as close as I'm going to get at the moment with this camera before its autofocus goes haywire. And again, what seem to be some protective fuses actually soldered in place. They kind of got holders which are soldered onto the actual board themselves. Right, so I've gone and popped that kind of middle supporting beam that came across here. And we've got some nice big, what I assume to be power capacitors, and some nice heavy wattage resistors down below with some nice big diodes as well.
In the front, I've gone and taken the effort, and as most of you all know, this isn't my forte. I've gone and looked up a few of these ICE packages. So I'll just bring it in a little bit closer just to show you what they are. This unit over here, which is the new Voton, if I've got it correctly, this is a microcontroller. It's an 8-bit microcontroller, if I've got that correct. And then next to it, this package anyway, and I'm assuming some of the packages down here, this is a 2-input OR gate. So there's some logic gates over here on that IC.
Right, and on the side of the beast over here, I assume I can only see now, I think we've identified where the two EEPROMs are. This will be the one of them, and the other one was on the other side, the first IC package that we looked at. Below here, you'll see this IC, and I saw the kind of emblem, and again, I wouldn't recognize this, but it's Cypress Semiconductors, if I've got their name correct, and this happens to be a 256K memory. So besides that, that is the internals, obviously with the heatsink at the back, the big lumping transformer, and then obviously the microcontroller unit, and then over there, I presume those are drivers for the display up front. As I said, that chip over there is obviously the one EEPROM, and then on the side over here is where we have the other one. So it's those ones I'm going to remove. This is attached to the serial input of the actual device. I'm unsure why both of them would need to be replaced. Perhaps Paolo can ask the manufacturer why that is the case, but nonetheless, so it's that one I need to get out carefully, and then the other one. So let's see how we go. This EEPROM is the first one I'm going to try and remove. It's in a fairly tight spot. I've got a few tools at hand. I've got my sprodges and a screwdriver, so I'm going to try gingerly to get that out evenly from both sides so we don't bend any pins. Actually, as I'm doing this, a big thank you to Frankie for getting hold of these bits and pieces for me. It certainly has made life easier when trying to get things apart. Okay, the one side has come undone. Let's see if I can carefully flip the underside legs out. Okay, so that came out fairly easily. Now I've noted its orientation. Obviously you'll recall the wording was up that way, and this is the kind of top end pin one side of the package. So I'll just make sure I get that correct. There's obviously the same marking on the actual socket itself. Even if you didn't make a note of the orientation of an IC like that when you've taken it out, always look on the socket because there is a little nib there which will guide you. Okay, and what I have done prior to, obviously for one, I've gone and touched my anti-static strap. I've gone and touched something else to make sure I'm carrying no static. What I, and heavens, this is a long time since I've gone and flipped ICs in and out of some electronics. But sometimes you obviously find the legs can be splayed out. So I've just carefully checked to make sure that they're lined up and straight. So it should help with getting the package in fairly easily. Okay, so before I push it in, I just want to make sure, yeah, looks like all the legs are lined up in the socket, he says. Let me just look at the top. Yeah. Okay, that went in fairly smoothly and easily. Make sure no legs have managed to straggle out. No, and it's in the right way. So that's the first one done. Now we get to the next one. Right, so here's this one on the other side. This one might be a little more fun. I mean, that's why I went and specifically purchased this puller. I don't think I've ever removed one of these packages. Certainly in the days many, many, many years ago at college when I might have pulled an IC out of a piece of electronics. I certainly can't remember removing a package like this.
So I literally went onto Amazon once I had a look at the package that Paolo has sent me. I looked it up to understand its identification because I certainly didn't know off the, I should even say off the top of my head, I didn't know the name of the type of package. So I had to look up the type of package, then look up the relevant IC puller. So that's what I've done. So this could be quite entertaining. Obviously this device, it's designed, it's got these two hooks. It's kind of sprung so that when you push it, it pulls up and you've got the kind of profile where the IC in theory should fit in there. But anyway, so let's see how well this novice can get in and remove this IC. Now I just want to make sure orientation wise, yeah, there's a little nib on the corner down here and I can identify the nib, and there's also a dot. So just to show you, there is a dot on the top of the package here as well. So orientation won't be an issue. So the one thing I've got to be wary about is this little board is not well supported. So I've got to be careful because I don't want to push too hard and obviously do any damage. Right, so I think I may have made a mistake perhaps in not understanding that there might be different size tools is what I'm assuming. This I can get, I can place one of these hooks under the IC by itself, but then I cannot get the other one in. And obviously going in at this angle like that, they're coming in like that. So to get under the chip is a problem. I need them parallel to go in and then hook in and then pull out. So that's certainly a lesson, I assume, that I've got a tool that's slightly too big. So I'm just going to have to do the best of it and carefully try and use this tool to nonetheless get this out. If I really am battling and I think I might cause damage, I may have to stop, but we'll just play it by ear. So as you can see, these only become parallel at that size. So I'm sure these are made for bigger packages and packages not that small. I'm trying to get in at that angle, and as you can see, the hooks then don't go in parallel. So there we go, a little lesson learned. Right, I've decided if I'm going to be fiddling around to get this out, this is a bit precarious in this position. So I am going to remove this board and do it on the bench. Okay. So I've now got it on the edge of my bench so that it's got a nice firm sitting position, because obviously it's got this plate on here, which obviously would still potentially put a bit of stress on the board if you're pushing on it. So on the edge of the bench, I've got it nice and flat, and I'll see how well I can do with that. Okay, so in the end, what I did, I went back onto my PC to see if there were smaller versions of this, and there didn't seem to be. There might be out there. It certainly wasn't going to get the prongs in straight down. So as you saw, what I did was just individually put the prong down the side and carefully just lever up each side alternately until I've got this package out. But anyway, that was successful. It was a little scary. I thought, you know, you kind of just have to gently apply a bit of force in here. It's carefully squeak out, but it came out fine, and there's certainly no damage to the actual IC socket. So what I'm going to do is place the other one in there, and again I'm just checking the identification on the one I've removed. You can see the dot at the top there. There's also an arrow in the actual socket itself, giving you some idea of the orientation. There we go. Putting it in was far less drama. That went nice and easy. I just made sure I applied even pressure to get it down straight. And there are little pins underneath that kind of catch it to, so that you know it's actually seated in the right position when you get it down there. So there we go. I've installed the board, screwed it back in, plugged the plug back on. The updated firmware on this kind of serial interface into the power supply is now installed. I'm now going to put the top back on the actual power supply. And then obviously we hope for one that it powers up, and then two that we've got the firmware bug and issues sorted out with the overcurrent protection. Right, so the moment of truth, I've got it all back together. I've got the inputs connected up to my electronic DC load. It's powered on.
pass, ROM data pass, memory data pass, calibration data pass. Bang. Okay, so it looks like we're in business. So let's try again. I'll bring you a little bit closer and then we'll see if the bug has been resolved. All right, so I've got my load back on. I'm going to initially switch the overprotection off, current overprotection, and let's just see if the normal operation works correctly. Got the output on, 5 volts at almost 1 amp. There we go, so it's operating correctly there. The current control has come on at 1.5 amp. Take it back down below the, below the point it was giving a problem before. And now we'll put the overcurrent protection on. And the moment of truth was I think around 750 milliamp. Yeah, we've gone past that. There we go, that's what it should be doing. Okay, so it's behaving correctly. The firmware they've engineered certainly has resolved that problem. What I'm going to do, I'm going to take it into its normal single mode or independent mode just to make sure it's operating correctly there now as well. So here we go, independent. Let's check, set the current level to the same. Okay, so I've set the current to 1.5 amp again. We're on the 5 volt mark. The overcurrent protection is switched off. We switch it on straight away. I left the electronic DC load. It's drawing above 1.5 amps. So let's just go down, back up. So that's operating correctly. Let's go back down, switch on the overcurrent protection, which of course we should switch off the output only when we get to 1.5, 3, 1.4. 1.5, bang, there you go, and it jumps in. Brilliant, so it's operating as it should do. Right, so there you go, all sorted at the end of the day and ready for whoever's gonna win it. The draw will happen literally with probably within the next week, so I'll draw it and then it'll be shipped off to the winner of that competition. A big thank you to Paolo and to Isotech for one, jumping in after I showed them the video with the issue. They jumped in, and the engineers and the factory went and developed new firmware. Obviously not an easy change because there was no way to do it via USB or the serial input. It had to have the ICs replaced, unfortunately, but nonetheless they did it. They shipped the ICs to me and that's done. And obviously all the new units will have the updated ICs. Having the right tools for the job certainly does make it easier. I'm not sure, and I'm keen for input down below. Please let me know whether there are smaller versions of these IC pullers, because I thought this would do the job, but I think this is slightly bigger. And at my quick scan while producing this video, I couldn't see a smaller version of this. And ideally, I'd imagine you want to get this in and just squeeze and lift the IC out, but I couldn't do that. And again, Frankie, thank you. These little projects came in really handy for that job as well. So thanks very much, and I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers.